Hachette Audio presents Conviction, written by Denise Mina, read by Cathleen McCarron.
One belief is that violence is caused by a deficit of morality and justice. On the contrary, violence is often caused by a surfeit of morality and justice, at least as they are conceived in the minds of the perpetrators. Steven Pinker, The Better Angels of Our Nature. Prologue. Just tell the truth. I've said that to my own kids. What a ridiculous thing to teach children. No one wants to hear it. There has to be a reason to tell the truth. I stopped some time ago, and let me tell you, it was great. Best decision I ever made. Lie and lie again. Make up a name, a background, your likes and dislikes. Just fabricate the whole thing. So much more rational. But I'm telling you the truth in this book. There's a very good reason for that. I ruined my life by telling the truth. I was very young. My mum had just died. Men gathered in my garden at night to shout abuse at my house because I wouldn't lie. Everyone started discussing what was wrong with me, with people like me. Someone nailed a dead cat to my front door in protest. A man broke into my house and tried to kill me to shut me up. So I shut up and I ran. I changed my name. I became secretive and careful and sealed off that part of my life. I never told it again. When anything even touching on that story came up, house fires, Gretchen Tiegler, football, I went to the loo or changed the subject. I didn't feel as if I was lying. I just wasn't Sophie Buchanan anymore. I was Anna McDonald, and those things were nothing to do with me. I felt safe. When you're tired and young and frightened and the whole world hates you, shutting up is luxurious. But now I'm telling that story again. Why am I writing a whole book about it for you to read? What changed? I wouldn't be doing it if my life hadn't imploded that morning. I'm no hero. I'm not a whistleblower of tremendous personal courage, content to be hounded to my grave because I will not be silenced. I'm truth-telling for a very different reason. It's less laudable, but a bit more relatable, maybe. And it's the truth. Chapter 1. The day my life exploded started well. It was early morning in November and I woke up without the use of an alarm clock. I was pleased about that. It was a concession to our couples counselling. I wouldn't wake Hamish at 6 with my alarm clock, and he wouldn't play Candy Crush on his phone all evening while ignoring the children. I was looking forward to my day. I had a new true crime podcast series waiting on my phone, and I'd heard good things about it. I planned to listen to the first episode, get a taste for the story before I woke the kids for school, and then binge on it while I trawled through a day of menial tasks. A good podcast can add a glorious multi-world texture to anything. I've resisted an Assyrian invasion while picking up dry cleaning. I've seen justice served on a vicious murderer while buying underpants. I lay in bed, savouring the anticipation, watching light from the street ripple across the ceiling, listening as the heating kicked on and the grand old dame of a house groaned and cracked her bones. I got up, pulled on a jumper and slippers and crept out of the bedroom. I loved getting up before everyone else, when the house was still and I could read or listen to a podcast alone in a frozen world. I knew where everyone was, I knew they were safe, I could relax. Hamish resented it. He said it was creepy. Why did I need this time alone, sneaking around the house? Why did I need to be alone so much? Trust issues, the couple's counsellor called it. I tried to reassure Hamish, I'm not planning to kill you or anything. But that was not reassuring, apparently. In fact, Anna, it might sound rather hostile to Hamish if you think about it from his point of view.
Really?
I said it in a hostile way. Does that sound hostile? Then we talked about that for a while. It was a stupid process. We were both hostile and sad. Our relationship was in its death throes. I tiptoed across the landing, skirting the squeakiest floorboards, and looked in on both of the girls. They were fast asleep in their wee beds, school uniforms laid out on chairs, socks and shoes, ties under collars. I wish I had lingered longer. I would never see them so innocent again. I went back out onto the landing. The oak banister curled softly from the top of the house to bottom, carved to fit the cup of a hand, grainy to the touch, following the wind of the stairs like a great long snake of yellow marzipan. It led down to a grand hallway with marble pillars flanking the front door, and a floor mosaic of Hamish's ancestral coat of arms. The house was bought by Hamish's great-grandfather in 1869. He bought it new from Greek Thompson. Hamish was very proud of his background. He knew nothing at all about mine. I must emphasise that. I'm not just saying that to protect him now that everything has come out. He was a senior member of the bar, hoping to be appointed to the bench like his forebears. He wouldn't have risked that just to be with me. When we met, I was Anna, the new office temp from somewhere outside of Aberdeen. I chose Hamish quite carefully. I did love him, I must say that, and I still do, sometimes. But I deliberately picked an older man with money and status, a declamatory man full of facts and opinions. He was the perfect hide. Hamish was born in that house and had never lived anywhere else. His family had been on or near the Scottish judiciary for 200 years. He didn't much like foreign travel. He read only Scottish writers. That seemed so weird to me. I think I found it a little exotic. It was cold in the hall that morning. I walked through into the white gleaming German-designed kitchen and made a pot of strong coffee. I picked up my phone. The true crime podcast series was called Death and the Dana. The description read, "A sunken yacht, a murdered family on board, a secret still unsolved." Oh yes, ponderous tone, secrets, murders, it had everything. And the case had happened while my girls were small, a time of little jumpers and waiting outside school, standing silently with the timeless phalanx of mothers absent from the wider world. I didn't know anything about this murder case. I poured a big mug of coffee, sat down, put my phone on the kitchen table in front of me, and pressed play. I expected an absorbing, high-stakes story. I had no idea I was about to meet Leon Parker again. Chapter 2. Episode 1. Death and the Dana. Hi, I'm Trina Keeney, a producer here on the Miso Network. Welcome to this podcast series, Death and the Dana. According to French police, this strange and troubling case is closed. They solved it. Amila Fabricasse was convicted of the murder of three members of the same family on their yacht. But Amila Fabricasse could not have done it. The murders could only have been committed by someone on board, and multiple witnesses, CCTV and passport checks place Amila on an airplane, flying to Lyon at the time. On the night in question, a wealthy family, a father and his two children, were having dinner on board their docked private yacht, the Dana. The crew had been sent ashore at the father's insistence, and the family were alone. While Amila was in the air, the boat motored out of port in the dark. No sails were set. Radio and navigation lights were off. Still, the Dana navigated the tricky sandbanks of the Pertuis Breton Strait, changed course by 32 degrees, and headed out into the Atlantic. Several miles out to sea, an explosion in the hull sank the ship. All three people on board died. So what could have happened? Why were the authorities so determined to believe something that was provably not true? And why has there never been an appeal against the conviction? Even before it sank, the Dana had a reputation for being haunted. Superstitious commentators immediately seized upon the sinking.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.